What would you see if you were traveling at the speed of light? One of the quirky things we can notice in our day-to-day is when we're in a car and we look inside the car and outside, not at the same time, obviously, but making a comparison of the two points of view. Every kid has done this experiment without noticing, where one day you lean your head against the car window and watch the difference in perspectives. Inside the car, it feels like everything's at a standstill. But if you look outside, it's like the world's coming at you at the speed that is showing on the car's speedometer. And someone on the outside looking in, seeing your car drive by on the street, would just see a car cruising down the road. And this is a curious experiment that helps us get a better grip on how things look from different perspectives. This was already a phenomenon spotted since the 17th century by Galileo, which was later put into Isaac Newton's laws of physics. And that provides us with some valuable information. For example, you can determine relative speeds. When you're driving and there's a car coming towards you, you perceive it as moving faster than it actually is to someone watching from the sidelines. And that's where the idea of adding or subtracting speeds comes from, depending on the direction and way they're going, to find the speed relative to something. And this functions, and has functioned, flawlessly for the speeds we handle with here on Earth, which are extremely slow. Back when those motion laws were formulated, no type of ride had the ability to exceed 60 kilometers per hour. It was only a bit later, when they came up with electromagnetism, that a really odd speed popped up in the equation. 299, 792, 458 meters per second. This speed is very unique in physics. It's the speed at which light travels through a vacuum, and the scientists were really keen on figuring out how this speed could change depending on the point of view, because that's what Newtonian physics dictated after all. You can add or subtract speeds to find the relative speed. And after a bunch of experiments, with the most famous being the Michelson-Morley experiment, physicists finally figured out that this speed didn't depend on the frame of reference. Regardless of the method used for analysis, the velocity of light will consistently remain unchanged. And that conflicted with what Newtonian physics stated regarding frames of reference and the functioning of relative speed. It's almost like at super high speeds, physics starts playing by a whole different set of rules, and this caught the eye of one physicist in particular, Albert Einstein, who then started to wonder how to work with reference frames moving at super high speeds. The outcome, following a few years, was the emergence of special relativity. One of its key pillars is exactly how we perceive things and feel the passage of time from different perspectives. Special relativity didn't just come up with a way to answer that question, but it also showed that there's no such thing as a favorite frame of reference in the universe. And I want you to hold on to that statement tight, because we're going to need it in a bit when we dive into the existential crisis part of the video. Special relativity brings about some quirky effects that you've probably already seen on the channel, ranging from time dilation to the contraction of space. And as you approach the speed of light, these effects become increasingly more intense. So, that's where the video's big question pops up. What would you see if you were cruising at the speed of light? And that's what I'm going to try to answer in this video by taking you on a journey at the speed of light. Our journey kicks off at 11 kilometers per second, which is the speed needed to break free from our planet's gravitational pull, also known as Earth's escape velocity. We haven't observed relativistic effects at this speed yet, so we'll keep on trucking. We raised it to 42 kilometers per second, the speed required to escape the sun's gravitational pull and travel out of the solar system indefinitely. If you're thinking that the speed would have us squished or pushed, you can relax because we wouldn't even be able to feel it. The sensation we experience when we are forcefully pushed back into the car seat is known as acceleration. And as long as we increase our speed gradually, it feels as if we are firmly grounded on Earth. Actually, fun fact, if we were speeding up at exactly the same rate as Earth's gravity, which is about 9.8 meters per second squared, it would take us about a year to hit the speed of light. So now all we gotta do is step on it. As we approach the speed of light, certain quite extraordinary effects begin to manifest. The first one is the Doppler effect. This is the same effect we experience on Earth when an ambulance is coming towards us and then moves away from us. As it heads our way, the frequency of the sound waves goes up, making it sound higher pitched to us than it actually is. And when it goes by us and starts to distance itself, the opposite happens, and we start to hear the siren sound get lower pitched. The same thing occurs with light. When a light source is moving away from us or approaching, the speed remains constant. but the frequency, which determines its color, changes, causing us to perceive it slightly differently than when it was emitted. When we are moving rapidly towards a light source, the frequency of the light waves keeps increasing, while the wavelengths of the waves become progressively shorter, resulting in the light appearing more and more blue as we approach. And that's what they call the blue shift. And when we move away from the source, the opposite happens. The frequency continues to drop and the wavelengths continue to get longer, resulting in the light becoming redder and redder. This is the red shift. Now, in our case, when moving at the speed of light, it is like in front of us we can only see an X-ray, while behind us we are going to see just infrared. Let's assume we were heading towards the Crab Nebula at the speed of light. While we are moving towards it, we would see it like this. But the moment we get past it and start to pull away, we'll see it kind of like this. Our eyes can only see the tiny slice of the spectrum that's visible light. So, in reality, anything located in front of us would have a bluer tint, whereas what we have left behind would appear more reddish in color. A whole lot would simply be imperceptible to us, because it would arrive in wavelengths that we are unable to perceive. But as nothing in the universe is as simple as it seems, the images wouldn't quite be like that. Actually, ahead of us, everything would seem a lot brighter than behind us. So, it would be like witnessing extremely bright lights in front of us and darkness behind. And this occurs because as we move closer to the photons, a greater number of them will come into contact with our ship and our eyes. And keep in mind, brightness is the level of intensity of photons when they reach an observer. The photons coming from behind end up spreading out all over the place and don't hit a specific spot. Besides looking super bright, the stuff we're checking out will seem way farther away than they actually are. And this is where things start to become interesting. First of all, we have to remember two effects that everyone has heard about: space contraction and time dilation. According to the theory of special relativity, the closer we get to the speed of light, the more space and time get all warped for us compared to someone watching from the outside. The shrinking of space says that at speeds close to light, we'd start to see everything squished together. Let's say there's an asteroid 1 kilometer long outside the ship, and we're cruising at about 90% the speed of light. For anyone within the spacecraft, the asteroid would only have a length of approximately 400 meters. It would literally look squished. And that applies to distances as well. It is like all the distances just shrink for us, making everything feel closer. So a journey that covered a distance of 1 million kilometers for us would only be equivalent to 435,889 kilometers. But that might give off the vibe that we'd see the universe as flat and everything closer to us. But we're talking about relativity, so there's always a but in there somewhere. The first but is that, yeah, even though distances are getting shorter, we'd still see everything as farther away than it actually is. And that happens because the angle at which the light hits us changes due to the contraction of space. And an analogy from classical mechanics goes like this. Picture this. You're on a bike, cruising in the rain, and the rain is coming down straight. No wind blowing it sideways or anything. It simply goes, bam, directly to the floor. The quicker you ride your bicycle, the more it feels as though the rain is slapping your face from the side. And the faster you go, the more it seems to fall on a slant, until you get to a point where if you had legs strong enough to hit extreme speeds, at a certain point you'd feel like the rain is actually coming down right at you. And in the theory of relativity, that also happens. And it happens with the speed of light. Its angle gets more and more twisted, making it seem like everything is coming at it head on. And when I say everything, I mean everything, even sources that are behind you. It's as if the entire observable sphere surrounding you is directly in front of you. And with that, it's as if objects begin to appear smaller and you are left with a wide-angle perspective. It is as if the entirety of the universe is captured in a panoramic photo lens that is offered up by the theory of special relativity itself. So, that effect I was just talking about, where everything behind us would look redder and darker while everything ahead would appear bluer, would actually happen. However, all of this would go down right in front of you. It is strange to think that what was behind you is now directly in front of you. In order to accommodate all of that in front of you, things appear smaller and more distant than they actually are. And if that's already weird, then I've got some good news and some bad news for you. The unfortunate news is that things are indeed flatter as a result of the shrinking space that has occurred. The positive news is you do not have to worry, because for us on the spacecraft, it is as if they are not even flat. Okay, now things have become real. things are all squished because we are in close proximity to the speed of light. However, they are not flat because we are closer to the speed of light. It's all an optical illusion. Basically, the photons on the far side of objects would take longer to get here because of the distance than the photons on the side closer to us. Besides, it's like everything's spinning around us even if it ain't actually spinning. This effect is known as Terrell rotation or Terrell-Penrose effect. One quirky thing about this effect is that if you were cruising through the solar system at a speed close to light, you'd see all the planets spinning way faster than their actual spin rate. And if you're thinking that space contraction caused a mess, so time dilation must be worse, relax. The truth is, the passage of time inside the spacecraft would seem normal, even though, when compared to an outsider, it's like time moves at a slower pace. That's where the idea of the twin paradox comes from, where one ages faster than the other. If you came back to Earth, you'd see folks here aging faster than you. But for you, time would pass normally on the ship. In a nutshell, if you were cruising at speeds close to that of light, the closer you got, the more the universe would look like just a bright, distant dot right in front of you. You could never reach the speed of light, but in theory you could approach it like 99.999999%. But the video question is what you'd see at light speed, and the answer is nothing. What a letdown. At the speed of light, there's no such thing as time or space. Everything's instant. For photons, time doesn't tick, let alone space. Their existence, in their frame of reference, is instantaneous. That's why it's impossible for us to talk about the referential of light. There's no frame of reference in a photon, it's like space-time just doesn't exist. For us, watching from the sidelines, we can measure even in light years away, because we can figure out how long it takes for light to travel from one galaxy to another and how much space it's covered. But to light itself, it's like everything's instant, like it was emitted and absorbed in a snap. For a photon that was created in the Big Bang 13.7 billion years ago and ended up on your retina is like time never passed for it. It's all in the same instant. So, perhaps the actual excitement lies in velocities near the speed of light, rather than at the speed of light itself. Now, we'll delve into the existential crisis section. At the beginning, I mentioned to keep in mind the words of Einstein. There is no preferred frame of reference in the universe. All frames of reference are equal. In other words, there is no benchmark to stop and say, this is the absolute reference point, and everything we see in it is reality. The frames of reference I've described in this video, with effects that seem bizarre to us, are as real as the frames of reference we experience on Earth. So, what I want to ask is, what is truly real? Or even better, what is the frame of reference that demonstrates what the universe is truly like? Ours? The one at 60% of the speed of light? The one at 90% of the speed of light? You might think an absolute frame of reference would be one that's at rest in relation to everything, just plain stop. What's a brief rest in the grand scheme? For Einstein, no frame of reference is ever at rest. If you are on a train in motion, you will be stationary in relation to the train, but not to people outside the train. And if you are standing outside, you are actually moving for someone inside the train who is watching. And both points of view are right on the money. Maybe for us, in the everyday world of Newtonian mechanics, it seems kind of obvious who's moving and who's not. But in relativity, it's not that simple. It's impossible to have a frame of reference that's at rest compared to all the others. So everyone's on the move and everyone's got, to a greater or lesser extent, those relativistic effects I talked about. For everything in the universe, it is seen in a different way, and they are all equally valid. Sure, we can always reckon that our reality is what we see from our own point of view. It's just wild to think that there probably are beings out there cruising at a chunk of the speed of light, and for them, the universe looks totally different than what we see. That's why the question still remains, what is the true shape of the universe? Do you think there's one out there? I'd love to hear what y'all think about this in the comments. Thanks a bunch, and see you next time.